You know, Davy's looking down saying, we should have gone to Hampden. Okay, that's all I'm saying. He has taken the last great journey which awaits all of us, unless Christ returns himself. And his journey has been akin to a ship sailing. A ship sails and I stand watching till she fades on the horizon. And someone at my side says, she is gone. Gone where? Gone from my sight, that is all. She is just as large as when I last saw her. The diminished size and total loss of sight is in me, not in her. And just at the moment when someone at my side says she is gone, there are others who are watching her coming. Other voices taking up the glad shout, there she comes. Davy has swapped the football field and the sidelines and the manager's dugout for a much better place. I don't know how two teams playing in heaven can win each the same match, but I'm sure they'll really enjoy it. A prayer for us. Lord God, comforter of all who mourn, strength of all who are weak, and peace giver to the restless heart, draw near to us now as we celebrate and give thanks for the life of Davy. And we do meet here this afternoon to celebrate and to give thanks for the life of David McWhinnie, commonly known as Davy. I'm sure other team members and opposition footballers might have had other names for him as well. But we do come with a range of emotions. There is no denying that. Sadness, shock, hurt and grief, because death, when it comes, is difficult to deal with. But I, as a minister in the Church of Scotland, believe that it is only a temporary passing and that he awaits us all beyond the veil. Your presence here is a strength and comfort to Betty, to Alan and Sharon, Gary and Debbie, as well as the extended family. And of course, to each and every one of you here, standing on the sidelines, sitting on the terraces, you have all had the pleasure and the comfort and the wonder of knowing Davy. Afterwards, you're invited to the Dalkeith Miners Club to share with the family all that Davy means to you. Death is a mystery, but Christians believe that it is not the end, but a new beginning. For through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we are able to pass through the door of death into a life of perfection and peace. Jesus said, for the moment you are sad, but I will see you again, and then you will be joyful, and no one will rob you of your joy. He also said, because I live, you too will live. Let's bow our heads in a prayer. Heavenly Father, you have not made us for darkness and death, but for life with you forever. Speak to us now your words of eternal life. Lift from us any feelings of loss and hurt and pain that we may have today. Free us from any anxieties and regrets, and bring us into the light eternal and perfect presence afforded by you. Set before us the glory of your love demonstrated so fully through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In John's Gospel, these words of encouragement: do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you, Jesus said. And if I go and do that, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. you know the way to the place where I am going. I am the way and the truth and the life, Jesus said. No one comes to the Father except through me. Amen. Each one of you here and your friends and family and people who just could not make it all hold part of David's life story in your hearts and in your memories. There's a poem called Life's a Dash, and it goes like this. I read of a man who stood to speak at the funeral of a friend. He referred to the dates on his tombstone, from the beginning to the end. He noted that first came his date of birth and spoke the following date with tears. But he said what mattered most of all was the dash between those years, for that dash represents all the time that he spent alive on earth, and now only those who loved him most know what that little line is worth. That love, the meaning that he brought to your lives, is encapsulated in all your memories and all the time that you shared with Davy. For in truth, we do not live in isolation. We live in and around friends and family, neighbors and colleagues. We have the ability to influence others and, of course, can be influenced by them. And as a stone that is cast into a pond causes ripples to spread out to the very edges, so our lives gently touch, caress, wash over, and sometimes overwhelm the lives of others. And you here today have all had the privilege of knowing, loving, and being changed by Davy. And I want that you are all the better for that. Davy was gifted to Katie and Alan on Monday, the 18th of December, 1950, at the family home in Ungerwood Road, Newton Grange. The fourth youngest, with five sisters and two brothers. Now, if you know the rhyme Monday's Child, you know that Monday's Child is fair of face, but in truth, Davy was much more than a handsome, beautiful face. He was kind and funny, a straight-talking man with a great sense of humour and a strength of character, both on and off the football pitch, but more of that later. He schooled locally in Gorebridge Primary, moving to Newton Grange Primary when he was just 8 years old, where he met his lifelong friend, Polk Gaffney. His schooling was complete at Greenhill High School. While at school, both primary and secondary, Davy showed a talent for football. He would captain their teams, leading Newton Grange through an unbeaten season in 1962, picking up the league title and the Drummond Cup. Such success continued as he led Greenhall High School to the school's Scottish Cup final in 1964. I bet when Davy left school, he thought his footballing days were ended when he joined the workers and the coal face of the Lady Victoria, that is. He left the minings for a brief period to work for Laidlaw and Fairgreaves as a carding operator. But in truth, he missed his colleagues, the close sharing that comes from working at the pit face on the mine. He missed the banter, and he returned to the Lady in 1974 and later on moving to Bilston Glen before accepting voluntary redundancy in 1986. Davy met the lovely Betty at the Lothian Arms in Dalkeith. Now, I'm told that Davy was 17 at the time, But he pretended to Betty that he was much, much older. Whatever was said in those first minutes and in the meetings there, something clicked with them. For they were engaged and married in this very church on the 10th of October, 1970. Betty, it's changed a bit since then. I hope you like what we've done to it. I am sure that many of you here will remember the reception in the Barley Bree East Houses. That was followed by a short honeymoon in Blackpool. But it wasn't in secret, the honeymoon, for they bumped into their friends Helen and Tony, who were married over the same weekend and just happened to have their honeymoon in the same town. Returning to Dalkeith, the happy couple lived with Betty's parents until they moved into their first, and it must be said, only family home in Waterfall Walk in 1971. It was a family home, I've mentioned, so Alan was born in 71, Sharon and Gary and Debbie followed in the ensuing years, completing the family. I'm told there was never, ever a dull moment in the house, with mum, dad, and four children growing up. Well, you can imagine that if you brought up your family. But the house became just a little more crowded when Davy brought home a lodger from the Horseshoe. Well, they were going to be homeless, and they were only going to stay for one night. But this lodger was different from ones you might be thinking about. It had four legs, a tail, and a big long tongue. Chess, the dog, stayed with the family for 10 years. And, you know, I think that's just a lovely little story because it demonstrated Davy's caring nature. He was at his favourite watering hole when a friend announced that he was having to find a new home for Chess. Davy, when he first heard that, point blank refused to take the dog home. But after a few pints, he warmed to Chess, and as they say, the rest is history. You might know that there were some things that Davy just quite couldn't get to grips with. Flying was one of them. He was never, ever fond of flying. In fact, he only set foot on a plane for one round trip. And I must say, he had a huge incentive for this. You know that. Because Debbie was playing in an international match between Ireland and Scotland. And to make the trip even better, she scored a hat-trick, winning the match for the Scots lasses. And that, of course, brings me neatly to Dave's big passion, which is, as you all know, football. I've already mentioned that he was a gifted and talented player. He amassed hundreds of medals over a long and auspicious career. He was a natural at the game. Now, I'm thinking, what do you think? Do you think that Davy and Walter Smith, are having a little bit of a chin wag just now in heaven? Maybe Davy's given him some tips on how he could have done his job better. A few chin wags in eternity. He started seniors football with Peebles Rovers in the late 1960s before moving to the National Coal Board Football Club. Firstly, as a player, of course, showing his gifts, his talent, his management skills on the field, and then returning to be player-manager of the teams in 1983 and 88. In between times, of course, he played for East House Lilies and Dalkeith Thistle. Dave always took great pleasure in reminding folks that he scored Lilies' first ever east of Scotland goal in 1981. Well, when you're as good as him, you would expect him to score well, wouldn't you? Football was in his blood. He loved to get out onto the pitch with the Abbey Inn or Bottom Shop in the 1970s, and he played with Bonnie Regan District Sunday Morning Pub League and in Dalkeith's Coaching Horses, where over a period of 5 years, numerous trophies were won. He was so good that he was headhunted as manager of Dalkeith Thistle, who were playing in the Junior League. When Davy joined them, they were the bottom of the league. And when you're in that position, there is only one way to go. It was the mid-season, and they had only one solitary point. But with David's gift of inspiration, of management, his fiery attitude, and presumably a bit of verbal coaching on pitch, they slowly, methodically climbed the league, missing out on the miracle escape due to a cocktail of goal differences and an old pals act, I'm told, it's not me saying this, between Whitburn and Camelin. Dave, as I said, was passionate about football, which I'm sure in his time led to the odd yellow and red card, especially from some disciplinary committees. When he was taken up before them, he seldom saw them eye to eye. But you know that hanging up his boots wasn't the end of Davy's football enjoyment, as he would urge Debbie and was really pleased, encouraged and proud when she amassed over 60 caps, and scored over 30 goals for the team at national level. Davy also liked other sports with the same passion, golf, cricket, etc., but it must be said, maybe more than an armchair position. Family was a big thing for Davy. You would think when he was out doing all that football work and the training and everything else and the planning and the strategy work that he wouldn't have any time for anything else, but he had time for his family. He welcomes his son and daughter-in-laws, Lisa and Keith, Claire and Sophie, and he just adored the grandchildren, Abby, Jamie, Katie, Gary, Danny, Carla, Lexi, Ross, Zach, and Myla. And they all loved him. Now, Davy's birthday's in December, and he always had a great big birthday party. But if you know the book The Hobbit, I think Davy was a bit like a hobbit, because when he had his birthday party, hobbit-like, he would give presents instead of receiving them, and he would give them to his grandchildren. Every single one of them would get a present. Betty might kill me for saying this, but I think it's a tradition that just needs to be carried on. So you have not got long to get it organised. Davy made lifelong friends and was delighted with Jim or Charles or Peter or another Peter or Polk would call in at the house and visit for a catch-up. You know, Davy was ill for over 10 years, but no one ever heard him complain. Even when his mobility was reduced and restricted, he would always delight in getting out every single day in his wheelchair, taken out along the riverbank, through the trees, seeing all the plants and the flowers. He fought many a battle, and when asked how he was, he would always reply, "As well as can be expected." Betty put it like this: "Medically, Dave was dealt a cruel hand. Along with COPD, he also had to fight sarcoidosis, Bethany myopathy, and silicosis. He fought without complaining over the past 12 years. He was in hospital numerous of times, but at the end, he couldn't get out again. All the family watched over him for days as he struggled to fight aspirational pneumonia, while in the background, his favorite songs were being played. He fought many battles through his life and won, but this time, Debbie says, the battle was over. This is the beginning of a long road where we will have to get used to the absence of his presence, a presence we all loved, a presence that you all here will miss, a presence which you will fondly remember and encourage others to do so. The family would like to thank Dr. Conlon and the nurses and staff at both Dalkeith Medical Centre and the ERI for all that they did to make life easier for Davy. There's more to say. Well, there is lots more to say. There's stories about the family holidays in places like Skegness and Morpeth, Blackpool and Great Yarmouth, or his love of long weekend bus trips. And if you go back to the Miners' Club, find out if it's true that he only ever liked the bus trips because he failed his driving lesson 5 times. Driving test, I don't know. No one's perfect, really. There is much more to tell. It's in here for you all. It's in here for you all as well. You have lovely memories. And before I invite Gary to read a poem and Peter to share some of his memories, I just want to remind you of this truth, that love and memories are similar. They only fade with neglect. Gary.
Fifty-one years have passed since Dad stood on this spot, put a ring on Mum's finger, proudly tying a knot. Our Dad wasn't perfect, tried always to please, a colourful character, I'm sure you'd agree. A captain, a leader, his passion was football. If you're in his team, he'd run through a brick wall. A win or a loss, red card or a booking, he loved nothing more than Betty's home cooking. Sunday roast or steak pie, her lasagna was gleaming. Then Big Davy woke up and realised he was dreaming. He loved a fish supper and chocolate chip cookies, but his favourite of all was a trip to the bookies. A trip to the horseshoe he loved for the lager. He'll be up the other now with Big Phil and old Dabber. Down the pit as a miner, deep down the coal shaft, horrendous conditions was where Dave had to graft. Got a job down the Windies, was great in the summer. Kenny Black, the main man, along with Big Skunner. A stint in Bob's bar for 2 years or more. Not one bit of hassle with Big Eck on the door. Big Dave loved his driving, he was ever so keen. Without doubt, the worst driver Dalkeith's ever seen. 5 failed attempts, Dave wasn't the best. Must have gave a backhander to get through his test. One thing that was special, he had so many friends. Loved him and with him, right to the end. Family meant everything, so where do I start? Amazing 10 grandkids loved with all his heart. To a lot of these two lassies, his bairns turned out braw, not to mention his son and his daughter-in-laws. Always there for him was Alan, their bond that was great. Not just a son, he was his best mate. Care for him, love him, take Dad his daily walk. Debs and Shan, you're amazing, you are Big Davy's rock. You're bright as a blackout, no right in the heed. His words made me smile, one-liners at speed. I'll miss you, Big Dave, hope you're flying high, keeping an eye on us, our bright star in the sky. Betty was his loved one, it took blood, sweat and tears. Lots of love and laughter for 50 golden years. A mum and loving granny, and always full of life, there for Dad until the end. She was. She was his loving wife. Strong-willed and determined, a fighter and a friend, he loved life to the fullest, never wanted it to end. His quick wit would endear you, his jokes would make you laugh, your presence will be sorely missed. We love you so much, Dad.
Someone else speaking?
Peter.
Peter.
I had this all in my head, what I was going to say, but I've had to write it down. I'll not be that Gary, though, I don't think so. Dave will not be liking this, me here getting the last word, and he kind of retaliate to me. Apart from the family, there's people in here that have knew Dave longer than me. I think I first met Dave around about 1974, 75, through a family tie with Daryl, and we've had a friendship of about 47 years. I played football with Dave in the 80s, and I helped him run a Sunday league football team down at the coach. We had some good times. And then when we hung up our boots, of course, we did a bit of socialising in those 47 years too, and we had many a good night. Going back to the football, it was quite fitting to see a photo posted by Davy's grandson, young Zach, in a sort of cartoon style, him being shown a red card by the referee. And it looks as if he was sort of pleading mistaken identity. I don't think so. I don't think so. I went on the park one day, I remember. We were playing a game, and we went on the park with 10 men. Big Dave had been sent off in the dressing room. That sharp tongue of his, no doubt. His son Alan reminded me of a game we played a few years ago, a charity game. We're playing up at Eastie's, I think, and Alan was a substitute, just a young guy then. And he brought Alan on in the second half, and his instructions were for his dad, he was right, get up that wing and chase everything, everybody. Alan was doing great. And then somebody on the sidelines mentioned here, young McWhinnie's looking quite dangerous on the wing, which his dad replied was, dangerous. That man wouldn't look dangerous with a machete in his hand. That sharp tongue. We've all had it, Alan. We've all been ridiculed. Don't worry, son. I used to meet Davy maybe on a Friday or a Saturday. Just to meet him in the Unicorn, meet up there early doors, and then we go up to the big city up the hill and have a wee pub crawl. And I remember one time we had a wee sort of run-in with a local constabulary, probably mistaken identity again. But anyway, we were bundled in the back of a police car, and I opened the other side, and Davey came right back out again. Of course, it ended up with two of us were in the back, and we're getting driven along to the station, and the policeman looked over and says to Dave, "What's your name, son?" And Davey said, "Kenny Black." And I shook my head. "Where from?" I said, "Newton Grange." I went, "Oh, no. That's the weekend in the cells for us now." Anyway, it just happened. It was a lucky night. The sort of radio went, they were to go to an emergency call, and he said, "Right, you two, get out. You're lucky." And he said to Davey, "Remember, Dave, we'll be watching you." So the real Kenny Black will be in here somewhere. Mind, they're still watching you, Kenny. I've lost my place here now, see. But we've all sort of got a story to tell about David, the guys that he worked in the pit with, guys that played football with before I even met him. Everybody's got a story. I can't even say anymore. Thanks for the memories, Dave. I'll miss you. We've had some laughs. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Gary, Peter. You add the very personal touch for that. And I know it's difficult to think that you'll be able to smile and laugh, but your memories will do that for you, bring that back in time. If you are able, we stand to sing "Morning Has Broken." Let us bow our heads in a prayer of thanksgiving. Almighty God, you are the author of life and the giver of victory over death itself. You deliver our eyes from tears, our strength from failing, and our souls from the grave. In your love for the world, you gave your Son to be our Savior, that we may, and we thank you that he conquered sin and death for us and opened to us the gate of everlasting life. We thank you for our loved ones who have found peace and life eternal, and who are only parted from our sight, and who live on in our hearts and memories. We especially thank you for Davy, whom you have brought safely through life's journey, and who even now has been reunited with friends and family who preceded him through the veil into your eternal presence. We give you thanks for his life and the way that he touched our lives, for his passion for the beautiful game, for his sense of humor, his straight-talking nature, his strength of character demonstrated every day throughout his life. We praise you for all the tender and precious memories that he leaves behind, memories that will bring a warmth to our hearts, a smile to our lips, as well as the occasional tear to our eyes. Lord God, Davy awaits us beyond the veil which we must all pass through. In time, we who die in Christ are reunited in Christ, even as our loved ones have been reunited. But at this time, Lord, we pray for strength to release Davy into your care and to rest content in the knowledge that his suffering has ended. To your loving care, we commend those who mourn his passing the most. Betty and Alan, Sharon and Gary and Debbie, Lisa and Keith, Claire and Sophie, as well as his lovely grandchildren. And of course, all of us who draw alongside them, sharing in the pain and grief. Sustain us in the days to come with our memories, and give to us a radiant hope of a future with you. And in the fullness of time, bring us to life eternal with your saints in the kingdom of heaven. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As we leave this place to say our last goodbyes, may you stand for a benediction here. May you know the peace of God the Father today, share in eternal life granted through Jesus Christ, and be comforted by the Holy Spirit. Amen.